Dyslipidemia Part 4, Laboratory Parameters and Lipid-Lowering Agents. May we introduce the bad cholesterol, LDL, and the good cholesterol, HDL. Maybe you already know them, for example, from the first episode in this Chalk Talk series on dyslipidemia. In particular, elevated LDL and triglyceride levels and low HDL levels are linked with an increased risk of atherosclerosis and associated cardiovascular diseases. But what exactly does elevated or lowered mean? Well, there are always new, inconsistent guidelines and controversial discussions about how to define these. In this Chalk Talk episode, we'll be looking at laboratory parameters of lipid metabolism in general and the various ways of positively impacting blood lipid levels. Let's start with laboratory parameters. Now, here, we're interested in the values relevant to the risk of atherosclerosis. To better understand these, let's look at lipoproteins again. HDL cholesterol is associated with a lower risk of atherosclerosis. Triglycerides are mainly found in chylomicrons, VLDL, and IDL particles. Their proportion in LDL and HDL is low. Both laboratory values, that is, HDL cholesterol and triglycerides, can be determined spectroscopically. Total cholesterol indicates how much cholesterol all lipoproteins combined carry in the blood. The LDL value is the most important risk factor for atherosclerosis, and therefore most relevant for target values and follow-ups. The laboratory parameter LDL cholesterol usually includes the values for LDL, as well as for lipoprotein little a, since lipoprotein little a belongs to LDL particles due to its density. Since the direct spectroscopic measurement of LDL cholesterol is relatively expensive, it's often calculated using the Friedewald formula. For this, the values for total and HDL cholesterol, as well as triglycerides, are required. Non-HDL cholesterol is understandably the difference between total and HDL cholesterol. However, the amount of non-HDL cholesterol can also be inferred indirectly by determining apolipoprotein B, in short, ApoB, since ApoB is found in all lipoproteins except for HDL. So this value is quite interesting because all ApoB-containing lipoproteins are atherogenic. The amount of lipoprotein little a, whose function isn't exactly known, is primarily genetically determined and remains basically constant throughout a lifetime. It's been shown to increase the risk of atherosclerotic cardiovascular diseases. As a laboratory parameter, lipoprotein little a is only measured once if a genetically caused increase is suspected. By the way, chylomicrons don't really affect parameters measured in the fasting state. They only form shortly after food consumption and are quickly broken down again. How high should the different blood lipid levels be, and how are they achieved? As already mentioned, this is subject to discussion among experts. In general, when setting target blood lipid levels, other cardiovascular risk factors need to be taken into account. For individuals with an overall high risk, lower blood lipid levels are recommended than in individuals with an overall low risk. So, in practice, the individual cardiovascular risk is always initially assessed so that the blood lipid levels measured can be interpreted correctly and appropriate target levels can be set. To keep things simple, we're presenting the reference values for an adult with an overall low risk. In this case, total cholesterol levels should be below 200 mg per deciliter and LDL cholesterol below 100 mg per deciliter. For women, the value for HDL cholesterol should be over 50 mg per deciliter, which is slightly higher than the value for men with over 40 mg per deciliter. ApoB should be under 130 mg per deciliter, and lipoprotein little a below 50 mg per deciliter. The triglyceride value varies with food intake and should be below 150 mg per deciliter in a fasting state, otherwise under 200 mg per deciliter. Dyslipidemias can be classified clinically according to various criteria. Principally, dyslipidemias can be differentiated into hyperlipidemias, that is, metabolic disorders with elevated blood lipid levels, and hypolipidemias with lowered blood lipid levels. However, hypolipidemias are generally rare. Only low HDL levels are relevant to the risk of atherosclerosis. Therefore, This is the only type of hypolipidemia that we'll be considering here. We'll now present a classification of the most important dyslipidemias based on a constellation of the different laboratory findings of blood lipid profiles. If only LDL and total cholesterol levels are elevated and all other laboratory parameters are normal, the dyslipidemia is classified as familial hypercholesterolemia. Also, if triglyceride levels are increased and HDL levels decreased, the condition is termed combined familial hyperlipidemia. If all values are within the normal range and only HDL levels are decreased, the condition is called low HDL cholesterol or hyperalpha-lipoproteinemia. In hyperlipidemia, triglycerides and total cholesterol levels are increased, whereas HDL levels are decreased, while LDL cholesterol is within the normal range. In the case of elevated lipoprotein little a, lipoprotein little a levels are increased, whereas any combination is possible for all other measured laboratory values. So these are the most important types of dyslipidemia. Additional information can be found in our AMBOSS article. Apart from the classification based on the blood lipid profile constellation, dyslipidemias can also be categorized according to the underlying cause. They can be differentiated into primary, that is, genetic and secondary dyslipidemias. Primary dyslipidemias are often due to dysfunctional lipid metabolism, for example, due to a deficient or defective apolipoprotein. In contrast, secondary dyslipidemias are complications. They can be triggered by poor nutrition, alcohol consumption, smoking, or underlying conditions such as type 2 diabetes mellitus, but also by drugs such as contraceptives, immunosuppressants, or thiazide diuretics. Pregnancy can also lead to secondary dyslipidemia, but it usually resolves after birth. So, what needs to be done if blood lipid levels are elevated? Even if it's not always the most popular measure, the first thing in an attempt to reduce lipid levels is changing your lifestyle. Depending on your previous lifestyle, a reduction in LDL levels of up to 40% can be achieved. This includes a healthy diet that is low in saturated and trans fats, salt, and alcohol. Body weight should be reduced to a BMI to approximately between 20 and 25 kilograms per square meter, and physical activity should be incorporated wherever possible into the daily routine. Smoking should be stopped or at least reduced. If these measures don't result in the desired blood lipid levels, or if there's an overall high risk, lipid-lowering agents are used supplementarily. In genetically elevated lipoprotein little a levels, or in exceptional cases when drug therapeutics fail, a technical procedure can also be used, lipoprotein apheresis. In this extracorporeal procedure, a machine is used to remove LDL, VLDL, and lipoprotein little a particles from the blood. In this Chalk Talk episode, we'd like to focus on the different lipid-lowering agents. First-line lipid-lowering agents are statins, because they're generally well-tolerated and can reduce total and LDL cholesterol levels by as much as 60%. Statins block the body's cholesterol synthesis by inhibiting HMG-CoA reductase. With this, they inhibit the key enzyme in cholesterol synthesis that converts HMG-CoA to mevalonate. As a result, cholesterol levels in the blood decrease, and cells compensatorily express more LDL receptors, therefore, absorbing more LDL into the cells. LDL levels continue to decline. Also, the amount of other ApoB-containing lipoproteins in the blood decreases. Subsequently, HDL cholesterol levels increase, whereas triglyceride levels decrease. Statins also have pleiotropic effects. These are effects which the active ingredient exhibits in other target structures in the body in addition to the known primary effect. Pleiotropic effects of statins include increased nitric oxide formation, reduced LDL oxidation, and decreased inflammatory and thrombogenic processes. These effects cause endothelial and plaque stabilization in atherosclerosis, therefore contributing an important additional protective benefit. Second-line lipid-lowering agents include cholesterol absorption inhibitors that reduce cholesterol absorption from food. One example is ezetimibe. It inhibits the NPC1L1 transporter in the enterocyte membrane, which is responsible for cholesterol absorption. Consequently, LDL levels decrease. Cholesterol absorption inhibitors can be used in combination with statins if the latter insufficiently reduce LDL levels. In such cases, both endogenous cholesterol production and intake from food is inhibited effectively. Another means of reducing cholesterol is to use bile acid resins, such as anion exchange resins, that increases cholesterol consumption in the body. This is how they work. The bile acids bound by the active ingredient in the intestinal lumen are no longer absorbed but excreted. The enterohepatic circulation is interrupted, and the body consumes more cholesterol through bile acid resynthesis. Blood cholesterol levels, therefore, decrease. Also, bile acid resins can be used in combination with statins. However, caution should be exercised in patients with high triglyceride levels, as bile acid binders can increase these blood levels. Fibrates intervene in lipid metabolism by increasing the activity of lipoprotein lipase. Here's a brief reminder. In the first part of this Chalk Talk series, we introduced lipoprotein lipase as the enzyme that cleaves triglycerides in chylomicrons and lipoproteins to release fatty acids. Therefore, fibrates lower the concentration of triglycerides and are mainly used in hypertriglyceridemia. Fibrates don't exert consistent effects on cholesterol levels, but are generally low. Their benefit in cardiovascular risk reduction hasn't yet been proven. Fibrates and statins are only combined in exceptional cases because this increases the risk of myopathy. A relatively new lipid-lowering agent on the market is PCSK9 inhibitors. They were developed mainly for high-risk patients who don't achieve optimal LDL cholesterol levels through statins or patients that don't tolerate statins well. However, this monoclonal antibody therapy is expensive due to production costs. They selectively inhibit the enzyme PCSK9 and therefore lysosomal degradation of LDL receptors. This increases LDL uptake into the cells and significantly reduces LDL cholesterol in the blood. The sole administration of PCSK9 inhibitors can reduce LDL cholesterol by as much as 60%, and in combination with statins and cholesterol absorption inhibitors by as much as 85%. Finally, we'd like to point out the lipid-lowering effect of niacin or vitamin B3, which is one of the oldest and inexpensive hyperlipidemic agents still used in the U.S. Niacin inhibits lipolysis, and therefore particularly decreases the level of triglycerides in blood. To a lesser extent, it also lowers LDL levels. Okay, so that wraps it up for laboratory parameters and therapeutic options of dyslipidemia. If you like, you can now test your knowledge with a quiz on the next slide.